right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. As promised, Jayanti will be providing us with a performance. So y'all give it up for Miss Jayanti.
But from the depths below, from where my spirit speaks, from the muddy shores, a subtle feeling grows that I've stood here before. Right where the river flows, when I washed my muddy hair by the banks of the Ganges, I heard a whisper there from my mother, and my mother's mother, they was singing to me. And petal after petal, I will settle on her back as she drifts to the ocean, into deepness turning black. I could wade in, I could let it wash me down, cover me, I would never again be found. That's how the river flows, not from the highest peak, but from the depths below, from where my spirit speaks, from the muddy shores, a subtle feeling grows. I've stood here before, right where the river flows. I said I've known it. Well, I've known that river too, and made me shiver until I turned the color blue. And from the dusky ancient Nile, when I was only just a child, I heard it singing, and it said, be free. Oh, but freedom, whereby the river found its chains, though I would travel, I could not go back again. So from the shallows, I will whisper to the deep, that I have known you, that you've been calling out to me. That's how the river flows, not from the highest peak, from the depths below, from where my spirit speaks, from the muddy shores, a subtle feeling grows. I've stood here before, right where the river flows, from the mouths of the banks of the Mississippi River. I will shout and give thanks to the water that's a giver, and though by steam they might conquer, I still you will never be taught by the shovel or be given a muzzle. For your mouth is muscle. By your voice, they do hustle. So speak out and let your voice flow out, and I will join you in song while we slowly do sing on. That's how the river flows. That's how the river flows. Not from the highest peak, but from the depths below. From where my spirit speaks. From the muddy shore. Subtle feeling grows that I've stood here before, right where the river flows.
All right, so our next speaker, her name is Sharonda Williams-Tack. She's currently an environmental state coordinator for the Sierra Club in Washington, D.C., and she's going to talk about a project that she's championed when she worked with an organization called We Act for Environmental Justice in Harlem. Please, everyone, give a warm welcome to Sharonda Williams-Tack.
Hello, my name is Sharonda Williams-Tack. I would like to first start by giving a shout out to Mahiar. Mahiar is the one that recommended that I speak at this year's Zero Waste Summit, so I really appreciate that. I am honored today to be amongst leaders in this field, and especially to be in a room filled with so many people that work hard every day to create better communities, which in turn creates a better world for all of us. I was asked to tell you a little bit about myself. I've considered myself to be an environmentalist since the age of 14. I took a really amazing marine biology class my freshman year of high school, and it taught me many things, but the most important lesson I learned was it taught me that as a human being, I had a responsibility to be a steward for this earth and all of its inhabitants. I'm lucky enough to be married to an amazing man who shares my values in environmentalism and also in social justice. I am the daughter of an immigrant that has shown me the example of what it means to be a strong woman, but also that I can accomplish anything that I strive for in this life. Thank you. I thank my mom. Professionally, I am the environmental justice state coordinator at the Sierra Club. My work is focused on climate justice issues, and I work on climate justice on the national level. I have focus areas in Illinois, Michigan, and the great state of Minnesota. So give up to Minnesota. I have been working in the pursuit of environmental justice for the past 6 years. And so when I think of zero waste as an environmental justice issue, I think of people using their limited income on reusable, non-toxic products that help them save money while also reducing health risks. Additionally, less waste, less toxic waste in the waste system means less of that waste goes into garbage burners, which are disproportionately cited in communities of color and are low income. I've been lucky enough to work with an amazing coalition based in Minneapolis, the Hennepin Energy Recovery Center, the HERC Coalition. They're working to shut the HERC down. And we've been working to make sure that Minnesota does not include waste incineration in any plan they put together to combat climate change in this state and in this world. I've been working in environmental justice for the past 6 years. I started my career in 2010 at a grassroots EJ nonprofit called We Act for Environmental Justice. I worked on climate justice as well as toxics reduction issues. And my work encompassed engaging with community members locally in West Harlem, working on toxics reductions and climate legislation in the state of New York, but also working on stronger federal protections. My favorite part of that job was definitely interacting and working with the community, but also figuring out that there was definitely a bridge between community engagement and legislative action. I would do these town halls in West Harlem where I would talk to people about the dangers of toxins in their personal care products and in their household products. We would talk a lot about chemicals of concern, brands of concern, safer alternatives to purchase, but also how people could support and advocate for laws that ban those chemicals in New York State. At that time, we were working on a bill to ban bisphenol A or BPA in sippy cups, baby bottles, and pacifiers. It took six years to get that bill passed, but we finally did it that year. And what I learned from doing these town halls was that when people are informed, they are then empowered to make positive changes in their personal lives. They can then use that education to create legislative changes, which create changes in larger communities. When it comes to being an informed consumer, there are many resources that people can look into when it comes to figuring out how to reduce toxins in your household and inevitably in the waste stream. I'm going to speak specifically about cosmetics and personal care products because if I went into all the products available that had toxins in them, I'd go way past my 10 minutes and be cut off. So there are two great resources that I love and that I look to. One is the Campaign for Safe Cosmetics, and the next is the Environmental Working Group's Skin Deep Cosmetics Database. The Campaign for Safe Cosmetics has a fantastic website which includes relevant regulations, chemicals of concern, but also information about a program called the Compact for Safe Cosmetics. The Compact for Safe Cosmetics is an agreement that was entered into with hundreds of companies where they agree to not put chemicals in their products that are banned in other countries, to disclose ingredients information whenever possible, and also to not include ingredients in their products that are known to cause cancer and or birth defects. The Environmental Working Group's Skin Deep database allows you to search for over 64,000 different products, which is fantastic. And when you put a product in, you can see whether that product has a low hazard, moderate hazard, or high hazard based on the ingredients in that product. And they also speak to you about safer alternatives that you can purchase as well. So, like I said, it's important that we are empowered to make changes in our personal lives, but if we want to, you know, expand that into changes for everyone, we have to look at what laws we have available. Minnesota's awesome. I did a lot of research about Minnesota laws and toxins, and Minnesota is definitely a leader when it comes to regulating the safety of cosmetics and personal care products. In 2013, Minnesota banned the use of formaldehyde in children's products, which includes baby lotions, bubble baths, bath soaps. And I'm sure many in the room know that, you know, Johnson & Johnson was one of those companies that families used for generations, and they had formaldehyde in their baby shampoo. They have since removed it, and now it's just called a new formula. They're not acknowledging that they're now taking those toxic chemicals out of products that are being used by children. Minnesota is the first state to ban intentionally added mercury in cosmetics, making it stronger than the federal standard, so that's huge. And yeah, give it up. And also triclothan, which is, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, triclothan is a registered pesticide which is found in antibacterial hand soaps, dishwashing liquid, toothpaste, and cosmetics, is going to be banned effective in Minnesota in the year 2017. Yeah, this is all great news. yes, that's there are a lot of good things going on in Minnesota. You guys are definitely taking the charge when it comes to, you know, regulating the safety of your citizens. But with anything, you can do more. How can we raise the bar in the state of Minnesota and make sure they're protecting their citizens even more? Well, like anything else environmentally based, you can look to California as a model. Yeah, right? So in, I believe, 2005, California passed state legislation that looks at regulating the safety of products, but also the way that information is being disclosed. the California Safe Cosmetics Act requires manufacturers to disclose ingredients to the state if they are found to be on a state ban or federal ban list, which is great. So this information then goes into a database, and this database is then accessible to the public. So though the state isn't banning these chemicals in the products, people are able to see this information and make more informed decisions as consumers, which is a huge thing. So in a nutshell, we can see that our federal government is not doing a great job. States are really taking it upon themselves to protect their own citizens. And so I wonder what you guys think. Do you think that this is a problem in other countries, or is this a, you know, a U.S. issue? Hands up if you think that other countries are doing a better job. So I'm going to talk about Canada, and I'm going to talk about Europe, because they're doing a much better job. They're kicking our butts. So Canada is doing a much better job when it comes to regulating chemicals in cosmetics and personal care products. Health Canada, which is the federal agency that is required to look after the health of Canadians and improve the health of Canadians, is constantly researching and looking at chemicals and seeing what has health risks. Once they ascertain that there's a health risk in a chemical or a contaminant, they either restrict or ban that chemical in their country. Health Canada also has a chemical hot list that has hundreds of chemicals which are banned in Canada. And two of those chemicals are formaldehyde and triclothane, which are not banned in the United States. Health Canada also requires manufacturers to disclose ingredients information and also to register any of their products. So that's a huge thing. The European Union is also doing a fantastic job, much better than the United States. The European Union created a law back in 2003, which was revised in 2013, called the European Union Cosmetics Directives Act. Within that act, they banned 1,328 chemicals that are known or perceived to cause cancer, reproductive development issues, birth defects, etc. Compare that to the US FDA that has banned 11, I repeat, only 11 chemicals in the United States. So we have, you know, very, very far to go. And so I talked earlier about, you know, my favorite part of my job at WEACT was looking at that bridge between, you know, how do we get people to change their personal behaviors, but also how do we then take the education and turn it into legal change? And so, you know, Minnesota is doing a great job, but Minnesota can be doing even better, and we have to do a better job when it comes to our federal protections. And that really takes people power, but also takes political power. And just to wrap up and to answer the last question that was answered of us, you know, what's something that we want to learn more about and what's something that's a challenge to us? And for me, I think the people power piece is really hard. And I look to, you know, the organizers that I know in this room, like Mahia and Janiece, and I'm sure there are many others who really do that work to really get people corralled around an issue. People have jobs and kids and other things that take priority. And so for me, it feels really hard to add on something else for them to kind of put their energy into. But this is an issue that, you know, really affects our daily life in the short term and the long term. And so we really have to, you know, come together and speak to our friends and families when we go home today about what we learned in this presentation, all the presentations and all the, you know, dialogue that you're having, and let people know that they have to feel empowered to lift their voices up and to make change in their lives, make change in their states, make change in their countries. And if we all work together, we can be a part of the change that we want to see in this world. Thank you.
Our next speaker is from Cooperative Energy Futures. Please give a warm welcome to Timothy DenHerder-Thomas.
Hey everyone, I'm Timothy DenHerder-Thomas. I'm gonna be talking to you about energy, and I was invited to talk today because there's a big connection here between the matter side of things and the energy side of things, and I sometimes like to think of these as the two sides of reality. I grew up in the New York City metro area, first in kind of the, like, Harlem Upper West Side area in Manhattan, and then moved with my mom when my parents separated to Jersey City. And really my childhood was about a process of asking, why are we doing things this way? It was really kind of a shell shock. We have built, you know, 100-story buildings all over this island. Where did that come from? Doesn't really make any sense when you're 3 or 4 years old. Grew up in a community where a million cars a day are driven from the suburbs on one side to the city on the other side through a place where most people don't have access to public transit. Why is that going on? Found out, you know, had health issues, respiratory issues all my childhood. Found out several years later, I live a mile away from one of the dirtiest coal plants in the United States, which is also located 4 miles from downtown Manhattan. It's kind of strange. So to make a really long story short, the guiding force or question that's guided a whole lot of my life has been feeling like the way a lot of things work in our society today is pretty silly. And we need to come up with a way of doing things that makes a lot more sense. All of those why questions, those how questions, those how is it possible that we do things this way, really led me to the energy system. Energy is what guides how we do all of this stuff with stuff. It's how we make all the stuff. It's how we move all the stuff. It's how we dispose all the stuff. And it's in our lives all the time, and we don't think about it very much. I don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to talk about a very, very specific solution that we're working on here in the Twin Cities, and I'll talk about a specific case study as well. So there we go. I work on community solar. Cooperative Energy Futures is a member-owned cooperative, meaning we're a member-owned business. And we develop community solar gardens that are providing accessible, clean energy to really anyone with an energy bill. Historically, if you wanted solar, you had to put up the money yourself, put it on your own roof, you had to be a property owner, so all these things that you had to do that, you know, the vast majority of us don't have. Community solar is a business model that was really introduced in Minnesota in 2013. And to make it really simple, the way it works is you have some location, could be a big building, could be a parking lot, could be an open field, that is willing to host solar. You have some developer, and a lot of these are private companies, we do this as a co-op, build a large solar array on that site and deliver energy to the electric grid, in our case, XL Energy. We then sign up ordinary people in the community who are subscribers. You can be a renter, you can have a house that doesn't have good solar access. Anyone with an energy bill can participate. And XL, or whatever the utility is, gives a credit on the bill to that subscriber. This is the basic model of what we do. We've also done a number of other energy services over time. There's lots of companies doing this, but what I've found in the industry is that the most commonplace practice or standard is really to replicate the cycle of wealth extraction that has been at the center of our energy relationship for the last 100, 150 years, where a big outside company is coming in, building a big piece of infrastructure, and then we all have to pay for that infrastructure month by month through our energy bills. We want to change that relationship around so that the wealth generation of our energy system is going back to the people who are using it. And that's why we worked with a couple of other organizations to form the Just Community Solar Coalition, and these are some of the values that are at the core of this model. So we want to make sure that there's access, regardless of income, regardless of property ownership, all of these types of things. Focusing on job creation, and particularly addressing the racial disparity in employment here in Minnesota, which is one of the worst in the country, and making sure that we're actually equipping people of color and low-income individuals for jobs in the solar industry, because historically, solar industry has been real white. Then how do we make sure that this is deepening the relationships in the community and the partnerships so that people can actually take control of saying, this is how we want our energy to work? A couple of other things. Just a really quick example, our first project, which is going to be under construction in the next couple of months, is on the roof of Shiloh Temple in North Minneapolis. This is providing power for about 35 households, the full power needs for 25 years. We're able to deliver a cost of energy per month that is lower than the amount you save on your bill. So it's an immediate savings with no upfront cost. And we've partnered with a job training program to train local North Minneapolis residents in building this thing. We're doing a bunch of other projects around the Twin Cities. And we're also in coalition with a bunch of organizations that are working on the policy and kind of systems change work needed to get this done. There is a petition out about that on the action table, and I'm happy to talk with folks about all of this great work and how it connects to the overall transition to a better future.
Wanted to make sure I say thank you to Timothy as well as Sharonda. The next speaker that will be coming is from the Environmental Justice. She's a coordinator for Minnesota Neighborhoods Organizing for Change. Please give a warm welcome for Janiece Watts.
Thank you. Oh, okay, thank you. There it is. So I wanted to answer these questions kind of with my story. So recycling for me was just something that my family and I always did. Growing up, I quickly became the enforcer for family gatherings to make sure that everybody recycled. Like, throw your cans at the recycling. It's not hard. So it was a complete shock to me when I started college. I went to Hamline University, started there, and discovered that they only had recycling in only three buildings out of our entire campus. One of them being my dorm hall, so lucky for me, I guess. But I just figured recycling was something everybody did. So I started organizing with MPIRG. Shout out to MPIRG. As my very first campaign around environmental justice to get recycling wide scale on campus. But it was a real education to me because recycling wasn't taught to me in this framing of zero waste. It was something we did because we knew these materials could be repurposed. And because when you grow up with practically nothing like my parents did, you reused everything you could. And so that's how they taught me about this importance of zero waste. You did it out of survival and make and do with what you had. So this experience was really clarifying for me for many reasons. One, I started organizing, of course. But it started to see that environmental issues are framed in a way that was really of the system of white-centric privileged environmentalism. Because believe me, even though as hard as I tried, the narrative of our campaign wasn't around repurposing the really importance of recycling and reusing. It was around being green, as it was a trend. So learning this really pushed me to seek out what environmental issues really meant to me, for what I understood to be environmental justice. Even though I didn't have the language for it then, we weren't really calling it environmental justice, but I knew it couldn't only be defined via defined environmental issue in that way, because it was something much more closer to me and how I was raised and about my family's history. It took me 9 years to find NOC and to know that environmental justice encompass everything that I felt about environmental issues. So that's why it's really important in order for zero waste to be equitable, that we evaluate it through the lens of racial justice. So people of color have been practicing zero waste practices for centuries. Thank you, right? We've been doing this and leading the way, but the mainstream environmental movement has largely, at best, ignored those cultural practices and at worst destroyed them. So that we don't see ourselves in this movement. Like I said, yeah, we've been doing it all along. So as well as policies like zero waste and sustainability sound, if they go unchecked by racial equity, then we will only continue these cycles of exclusive, unproductive, and false environmental solutions like the HERC incinerator, which is a garbage burner dressed as renewable energy that's continuously polluting communities of color. So that's why it's really important to make sure environmental issues are understood in a comprehensive manner so that it includes all issues so we can have holistic solutions. An economy that protects and provides for workers. An education system that teaches many different forms of environmentalism. So that our homes, our schools, and our workplaces are safe, clean, and prosperous. Engaging communities in this holistic view is the challenge that I face as an organizer, but it really gives the best opportunity to bring many different perspectives to the table for environmental justice. This opens up the space for many forms of environmental racism to be examined. I was asked to mention what really impacted me about going up to Sacred Stone, which I had the honor to do with a couple people in this room. to stand against the Dakota Access Pipeline up in North Dakota. This movement really illuminates the destruction of extraction on land, on water, and on people. People just like the environment are not to be wasted. The trauma that's been caused by environmental impacts us all on environmental harm impacts us all physically, mentally, and culturally. We must know that and we must name it if we really want to get to true zero waste solutions. So I'm really glad that the study of the environment has really expanded to include economics and health and culture. So that really means environmental justice. And it makes my work every day so exciting. And I'm really grateful to, like Brian said, to be living my dream. It's always been my passion to really examine environmental racism at the highest levels. So because this is also interconnected, and the more that we keep that at the center of all of our work, I know we'll get to zero waste future. Thank you.
Thank you, Janiece. Let's keep it going. Coming from PlayItSafe, Minneapolis, please give a warm welcome for Dianna Kennedy.
Hi, my name is Dianna Kennedy, and I'm here today to talk to you about a concerned group of parents that call itself PlayItSafe, Minneapolis. But I would be remiss if I didn't tell you that I'm just thrilled to be back here. It's like a really warm homecoming for me. I'll first tell you a little bit about myself. Do I push this button? The green one? Mm-hmm. That's my family. That's me and my family. That's my wife, Jen, on the right, and those are my kids, Stella and Darby. When Darby was born 2.5 years ago, I left my job at Eureka Recycling after 13 years to raise these little people and to make amazing Halloween costumes. It's true. Those are the people who raised me. That's my dad at the top and my mom below him. I grew up in Iowa, the daughter of this Iowa farm boy, and my dad was a chemical fertilizer dealer for farmers. And at a very early age, I learned the impact of big business, big industry, the chemical industry on a community. My mom there spends a lot of time being pissed off at the world, the way the world is, particularly around issues of power and women, and I love her for that. They can build anything, they can fix anything, they can make anything, and if you can't do those things, you shouldn't have that thing. That's where they come from. So, those are the people who raised me personally. The two people who I think had the biggest job of raising me professionally were this woman. That's Adrienne Christensen. She's a professor at McAllister College, and she was my professor when I landed there. And she had the gall to tell me I had no idea how to write. And I was like, And in proving her that I could figure that out, she actually taught me how to write and make incredibly solid arguments, not just based on what I believe. The other person, and perhaps the person who had the greatest impact on my life professionally, is one of my dearest friends, and that's Miss Susan Hubbard, who's in the back of the room. Yep. Under her leadership, I watched the zero waste movement really emerge from this very rich tradition of recycling. And I would say, with the exception of my parents and my children, no one else on earth has asked me to apply my talents and my time to making my community better than she has. So there you go, Susan. Which is why when I took my kids to a local neighborhood playground, and I realized we were walking around on shredded tires on a hot 90-degree summer day, and I was walking back from that stinky mess, and I was like pulling chips out of my one-year-old's mouth at the time. I was like, oh no, something is wrong here. And now I feel called to do something about it, right? And so I thought, I gotta call my people at Eureka. I gotta call up Brian and find out about tires and call. See, I gotta call. We're gonna have to get shovels out here and we're gonna have to just get rid of this stuff. So I started doing a little research. And what I found is that the problem was bigger, of course, than my backyard. The stuff on the bottom is what I'm talking about. It's called crumb rubber. No, I'm sorry. The stuff on the bottom is called tire mulch. And it's just ground up tires, basically, that they use in playgrounds. And it's in 47 elementary and middle school playgrounds in the city of Minneapolis. You can also buy bags of it at Home Depot if you'd like to put it in your own backyard, but I would not recommend that. There is another product made out of tires called crumb rubber. It's tiny, tiny little pellets, like tiny stuff. You can see it in the hands there. And it's used as infield in artificial turf. It's used widely. There are only 8 fields in Minneapolis that use it, but almost every single suburban area has those fields. So I was like, oh no, shoot, it's really big. Now I've got to get to work. So I started thinking, what the hell, whose idea was this? How does this happen? I called my dad, right? Because he's the one who tells us stories about throwing tires on brush fires on the farm to get them nice and hot, and they burn black, so they do it at night so the fire department wouldn't come. I thought he might know something about tires. He goes, that's a terrible idea. There's just nothing okay about that. When my dad says there's nothing okay about that, there's nothing okay about that. And so what we did is I started looking around, and I'm going to give you the most abbreviated story I can tell. If you want to know the whole history of how this happened, you come see me, and we'll go have a beer with Brian Ukenna, and we will sit down and talk about tires for a long time. But what happened was the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency got really interested in the stockpile issue going on in the United States, and it was a real issue, these piles and piles of tires building up. And they invested millions of dollars in tire mulch and crumb rubber and other ways to solve our problem with waste. They partnered with the rubber industry, they partnered with great states like the state of Minnesota, and they created markets for these products and persistently, that's right out of their marketing plan, persistently sold them. They funded the installation of fields and playgrounds in states like Minnesota, and Minnesota did the same. So school districts like Minneapolis believed the claims that these were safe products and, in fact, superior to that very dangerous wood mulch that gives you splinters, and that they widely installed it. Actually, that's a little bit unfair. They really were worried about kids falling off of really high playground equipment, and they were told that this was better for falls. I just had my daughter's cast taken off. She broke her wrist on this stuff from a very low monkey bar. Kids fall on playgrounds and break things. So the reason why this happened is, you know, nobody really looked at the health issues of this before they started looking at the waste issue of this. And it's a very easy and familiar story, right? We look at recycling as a way to solve our problems with waste, but you don't spend much time in the recycling field to know that recycling is not really going to solve that problem. So this little design just came up on Google when I was preparing for this, and I was like, oh yeah, that's right. We just manufacture them. They just show up out of nowhere, and then they're waste. What about before we manufacture them? Why do we need so many? Why are they made to be disposable? What is wrong? Why are they made toxic? What is the deal with these tires? Why aren't we spending our resources doing that? Because no amount of cute craft projects is going to solve this problem with waste. And I'm an expert, so I know that it's not going to work, right? So what we really need is to redesign them. And I can tell you that if we were to be looking at the best product to put in our children's play areas, we would not seek this material out. We would not go for this. This is not what we would pick. So you're just going to have to take my word as to why, but I'll tell you real quickly. It's because it's toxic. It's toxic for our bodies, and it's toxic for the environment. A recent Yale study really puts it, I think, the best. They say crumb rubber and tire mulch are a venerable witch's brew of toxic substances. This stuff includes carcinogens, allergens, irritants, endocrine disruptors, reproductive toxins, developmental toxins, and more. Which is hard, right? It's okay on a car. It's okay to put it on your tire, maybe, I don't know. But you're putting it in a kid's playground. Now, children, we know, are way more susceptible to this stuff. As Sharonda was telling you, kids' products are important because kids are sensitive. They're growing. They eat more food. They drink more water. They breathe more air than you do. They are developing. And I'm not talking just about little kids like mine. Teenagers are growing their brains and their reproductive systems and their neurological systems, and these things interrupt that. They also play in this stuff. Like, you would go to this playground and you'd be like, oh, we're just going to walk around on it. These kids, like, dig in it and throw it on their bodies and roll around in it, and soccer goalies are sliding into the crumb rubber
lots of cases of cancer among goalies now. There's a lot of anecdotal information coming out. And it gets really stuck in them. The other thing, the reason why it's so important to protect these kids is because they don't make choices about where they, what material is put in their playgrounds and on their fields. Their schools do, their parents do, the community does. So we have to make the right choices for them. In addition to our bodies, the stuff is also not super great for the environment. You can obviously see it spreads out all over and it goes down the storm drain. But it also gets stuck on their bodies, and when they come home with it, it's in your house and, you know, in your shoes. I know, it happened to me. My kid plays on one of these in recess. I was appalled to find it on the bathroom floor. But it ends up down your laundry tub drains, it ends up down your shower drains, and it's going to water treatment plants in our cities. It also is hot. It's hot stuff. They have found a man in New York, Stuart Gaffin, was studying hot spots in New York City, kind of looking at climate change, right? Because climate change is going to make everything hotter, and we need to keep our cities cool because they're dangerous places to be. And the hot spots that showed up on the map were chrome rubber fields. So they're going to have to be taken out. Now, I got the notice. I know. I'm going to rip through this. The good news is the state of Minnesota is paying attention. Our good friends at Healthy Legacy, who helped get BPA out of sippy cups and formaldehyde out of kids' products, are on this at the state level. Karen Clark has authored some legislation to try to put a moratorium on this material at the state level. Here in the city of Minneapolis, they're examining this issue in detail to try to figure out if it should be allowed. And we've actually talked to the folks at the school board, school administration, and they're listening and they're interested. Now, the two challenges which I will rush through to this are, when it comes to chemicals, the framework for how we look at them has been constructed by industry, not by public health. So the very way we're taught to think about risk and chemicals is based on, well, does it hurt us, instead of, is it safe for us? And so the onus is on us as citizens to say, it's not good for us, whereas the industry can say, well, you can't prove it's not. And so we have that really big hurdle to get over. Now we're coming in as a bunch of concerned parents, which I'm not used to. I'm used to walking in with the power of Eureka Recycling behind me. But as a bunch of concerned parents, it's very easy to discredit where we're coming from. And what I'm finding, and this is a particularly twisted challenge, is that, you know, this issue is coming up out of South Minneapolis. This is a bunch of white moms who are saying that this is a problem, which is great. Convincing them that they should be thinking about somebody other than their children and all the children in the city is totally doable, totally fine, right? We can get that done. But I found that now at the government level, we're hearing, well, we can't hear from you at all until we hear from everybody in the whole city. And this has to be an issue that everybody in the whole city cares about. And so now we as parents are now creating these great networks, which we can do, but it's hard. There's lots of parents with lots more challenges than I have to connect and reach out to every other community to raise this issue. And I don't know about you, but it's not like folks aren't busy up in North Minneapolis trying to get rid of a metal recycler that blows through their air permits and deal with HERC, which I don't have to deal with. But, you know, part of the reason I'm here today is that barrier is to say, okay, we need to be working with neighbors organizing for change, but I can't ask them to just come on board to the playground issue. All the moms in South Minneapolis have to come on board with HERC and come on board with the metal recycler so that we can fix all these problems together. So that's it. Thank you.
All right, so now it's time for the open mic. I'm going to pass one mic this way, and then where's the other mic?
Hello, everybody. This is Sean with the Alliance for Sustainability. And this is the year of comprehensive plans. Anybody heard of a city comprehensive plan? Anyway, all of our cities have to turn in a new 20-year vision to the Met Council by next January of 2018. So this is the time for you to check in with your city council member and let them know that you would like your city to reduce and reverse racial inequity, to also improve, to achieve our state goal of reducing carbon by 80%, and getting your city ready for the bigger climate impacts of heat and rain events. So if you'd like to learn more about how to engage with your city council on issues of health, Climate Inequity will be meeting this coming Monday, the 24th, over at the Wilder Center in St. Paul. You could join us in the afternoon at 1 o'clock with a bunch of city staff, or in the evening for the workshop with community volunteers and commission volunteers. We'll have staff from the Environmental Quality Board, Center for Energy and Environment, PCA, and others, so that you can learn how to be able to get your city to actually sign on to our state goal to reduce carbon by 80% so that we can keep our climate stable. And I have these yellow flyers here. Just let me know if you'd like to join us on Monday. Thank you.
Hi. So toxic chemicals, that's awesome to sort of start to look at those things in our cosmetics, but did you find any research on microbeads and the impact that they have on our waterways, or any, starts of policies in states like Minnesota or places in the Midwest?
Still on? Okay. I lived and worked in Chicago for a number of years, and my job before Sierra Club, I worked with an organization called Illinois Environmental Council, and they kind of spearheaded Illinois being the first state to ban microbeads in their states. So there's definitely a state to look to, and you know what that legislation looks like. And you guys have a pretty, government's not perfect, but I think you guys have a pretty progressive government. You have a pretty good governor who cares about environmental issues, and so I think it's definitely something doable.
But if I'm not mistaken, Minnesota does not have
a ban
on them.
Do you?
We just passed it because I know Wisconsin, Illinois, Michigan all did, but last year at the Zero Waste Summit, we had someone speak on microbeads, and at that time they did not.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't sure.
Okay.
Comments about the ants and the rubbers. I used to be an engineer. I'm not. I'm educated. I mean, I'm an engineer, but not anymore. But about the crumbs, the rubber crumbs, even if you remove them from the grounds, they still will be off-gassing. So if you properly remove them, they will be off-gassing. So you will need to have a proper way of doing them by sealing them the area. So that's you need to have a proper engineering, environmental engineering doing that. The second thing is what they're gonna do with the rubber, these rubber crumbs. This question is to her or to the team that they are working on that. Thanks.
Dianna,
here.
Is that you?
So there's sort of two issues. One is that there's the tire mulch in playgrounds, and that's really what PlayItSafe is focusing on. And I would say that's the easy one. Right? It's $1.1 million to clean up 47 playgrounds. You take it out, you put engineered wood fiber in, and that's good. And I think the school administration and the school board election coming up is really going to turn the tide, and we're going to be able to get that done this year. The real trick is the crumb rubber fields that you're talking about, and there's eight of them. And, of course, they're in the high-density communities of color in Minneapolis. That's where those fields are located. Those are much, much more expensive to take out. They're more difficult. There's lobbyists that are fighting to keep them in and add more. The talking about comprehensive plans, the park board is redesigning every single park in the city of Minneapolis. They just finalized the South Area Plan. It's got two more fields planned. They're kind of waiting to see what the city will do, if the city will say they can't. But that's sort of like up in the air right now. So there isn't actually any agreement to take any of these out yet. So there have been two communities that have been successful in doing that. Duluth is cleaning out the tire mulch from all of their playgrounds. They got that decision last year, and they're doing that now. And there was a man who worked in the tire industry, a dad in Minnetonka, who single-handedly said children shouldn't play on this stuff, and he threatened a lawsuit in Minnetonka, and they tore out six of those fields and put them in. So it's possible to do. So there is no actual agreement yet to get them out. So we're not quite yet at what to do, but there are communities throughout the country that are doing it that have some best practices we can look at. That helps. Okay.
Any other questions?
I actually also have a question for Diane. So I was wondering, because a lot of schools in my area like have the tire mulch, and so I was wondering, do the schools actually know that this is a problem? Oh, yeah, sorry. Do the schools actually know that this is a problem, or are they simply choosing to ignore it?
Well, I think it's a case where the schools and the teachers themselves have no control over what materials go into the playgrounds, right? And so they're under tremendous pressure to do a lot of things for our kids. And so they care. Of course they care about our kids. The school administration cares about our kids. But it's about who can actually make that decision to do it. We've been trying to educate people about hand washing, because the real issue is the kids play on the playground, the dust is all over their hands, they come in, they get a squirt of hand sanitizer, which helps that stuff stick to their hands more and absorb it faster, and then they go off to the lunchroom and eat with their fingers, even though my five-year-old should be using silverware, but she doesn't. So, I mean, the teachers are amenable to it, but they're just under a lot of pressure with testing, with high class sizes. I mean, they're doing everything they can, and to hear one more parent come in and say, you have to wash my kid's hands, it's really hard for them. So I would say there are some schools that are more fully educated and are doing what they can. I hate to place blames on the schools for not paying attention, because I think the district has told them it's safe. EPA told the district it was safe. The district told the schools it was safe. And so now we're undoing that language, and it's a very hard message to hear. So our strategy has been to really just get the school board and the school administration to make the decision to just handle it for the district.
We have another question up here. Did you still want? It's coming.
All right, my name's Esther Sia. I just moved here from Germany 6 months ago, and I have a question maybe to Janiece, maybe, but a general question, and my question concerns dishes. I find Americans are extremely excited about compostable dishes, but I really want my European dishes and silverware. So, and I especially find I'm a foodie, and I'm a political scientist, and I find I want to support small businesses like Pimento or the global Midtown Global Market, but I don't get dishes there, so I don't eat there because I just don't want to waste anything, not even the compostable dishes. So I was wondering, does anybody work on this? Does anybody care about this? Or are there, like, I think it could be an equity and an economic and a waste issue that could be tied together and could build a coalition potentially. But yeah, I just wanted to put it out there because I don't get excited about wasting compostable things either, and I want dishes in America.
Thank you. Yes, somebody does work on this. We are actually having a workshop on November 11th about compostable plastics. So, and it's including all kinds of... I'm sorry, 10th. I don't know where I got 11th. November 10th. we are bringing in the people who have done the research and to talk about that and what's compostable, why it's compostable, what's not compostable. And we are also bringing in someone who they certify the compostable, talking about the certification process. You guys are going to speak. Want to be one of our speakers about how you use it in your business. And we have Eureka is going to be there. Megan, I think, is, huh? Miriam? Miriam is going to be there, unless I have it in front of me. I will never remember exactly all the names. But she's going to speak about using it at events. And we have a long way to go. But we are also sponsoring legislation, or going to ask legislators, was there one here? Yeah. To do some amendments to the regulations that require that you don't make the compostability claim unless you truly are certified, and there's a bunch of technical stuff. And so, because there's some of that going on out there, and also getting the state to enforce it, working with them to enforce that. So, yeah, we are.
I would be more radical and use dishes instead of compostable ones.
Actually, yeah.
Like use dishes and use them again, especially in smaller restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, mine, they're a dishwasher. In hotels, I don't want to go to hotels. I bring my own breakfast because I get a styrofoam cup and a bowl and a spoon that's plastic. I don't want to eat that way, and I think it's an environmental and a racism issue and a labor issue. It's everything.
I agree.
Yeah.
So briefly, in regard to compostables, my name is Andy, I'm from Gandhi Mahal Restaurant, and we're heavily involved in composting, and I practice as close as I can to zero waste catering. But I think when we start talking about compostable and organics, we need to even step back from that and say, before it even becomes or goes into that material stream rather than waste stream, we should be trying to feed people with the edible food that's left over from our buffet. or whatever, you know, whatever case it is for people that do have the organic compostables, and then animals after that especially. So it never even gets to the point of going into worm beds or anything else for compostability. So, yes, Brian. And this is really part of the whole equity thing, too, from a social, racial standpoint, and too, in communities of color and everything else. There's so much we can do, and I'm so frustrated at Gandhi that we have food we would love to donate daily, but it becomes two issues of transportation and many groups that don't want to take the food once it's been on our buffet. And it's perfectly edible. And it's
can I answer that question?
It's not left over in the sense that it's perfectly fresh and edible. So nobody much. Else has eaten it. It's still
but
in
that's
the pan.
Yeah. Don't make so much. Don't make your problem ours.
No, and we don't. We cut it very close. But we
can I answer? That she asked. No, she addressed the question to me. I think you're right that like we need to be reusing our. We all have so many dishes. I mean, when we have like a community meeting, like we have at NOC next Wednesday, November 2nd. 6 to 8, you can come. I think it's a great idea to have actual dishes. I mean, we have a sink. We have a kitchen, and we use our own dishes at NOC. We're really trying to, like I said before, it becomes a recyclable or a compostable. We already have so many materials in the world. So I wish you could, you know, always travel with all of your dishes. I know it's hard. It's not something you can really do, like going to a restaurant. But you know, maybe it's something that we should start to push for our communities and for our meetings or restaurants. Like, let's actually reuse the things that we already have. So, thanks for asking. Yeah.
So, hello everyone. My name is Kelly Kish. I work for the city of Minneapolis. I just wanted to say, a couple years ago, the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency gave money to the Minnetonka School District to do a study on this. Because so many schools got rid of their washing machines because they thought that the staff time and the water costs more than going to disposable items. So that's when a lot of the schools went over to the foam trays and things of that nature. And so the PCA, through the grant, bought them all new reusable silverware, trays, all of that stuff. They, throughout an entire school year, measured the water usage, the extra staff time, all of that. Disposables are definitely not the way to go, obviously, for overall environmental health reasons, but it was also a cost-saving measure when those schools went back to reusable items. And just so for people who live in the Twin Cities areas, almost every one of the metro counties has business grants that businesses can get money, very easy grants to apply for, to add or improve recycling or organics programs. And some of the counties will even let you use that money to go from disposables to reusable items. So if you are a business owner or you are someone who holds events, look into those business grants, because nonprofits, churches, schools, everybody is eligible. Thanks.
Do you know where it's
essentially Google search your county business recycling. So Hennepin County Business Recycling, Ramsey County Business Recycling, and you'll find the information. But there are some resources out there, and those are not even going to be the only ones. I'm sure the PCA, through their grant programs, they're always looking for ways to reduce waste. So you could probably even apply for a PCA grant to do something similar.
All right, we're going to wrap this up. Good conversation. Please make sure you take all your questions and comments to the board. We're going to take a very, very short break, maybe 5 or 10 minutes. Grab something to eat, reconvene.